Actually, excellencies, distinguished participant, my role here is to welcome all of you and to give support to Professor Thitinan and his team to organize this important public forum. And also, this is another chance that I would like to meet with Professor Vitit, because we haven't met each other for some years already. So I take this opportunity to meet him. So I know that you are waiting to hear from Dr. Vitit and all other speakers. So just really short, welcome all of you. And I am certain that this a few hours from here, you will learn so much from all the speakers. Thank you very much.
We've been doing this series of forums on different current events. And you all know that we have had some problems in Thai-Cambodian relations, and it's debatable when this started, but the facts are that we have this temple, a Hindu, ancient Hindu temple from 1,000 years ago, that has been contested between Thailand and Cambodia, and Professor Vitit is going to give us a legal perspective. This is an important year in Thai-Cambodian relations, because the politics of the relationship has improved, but the legality, the legal dimension is contentious. And this year, the International Court of Justice is going to adjudicate whether the area adjoining the temple, Preah Vihear temple, in Thailand we call it Phra, belongs to whom, which country. And it's very murky. We expect the decision to be made sometime late in the year, maybe October, November. Professor Vitit is going to shed a lot of light on this. He has also some charts and numbers and figures and facts to reinforce his presentation. Professor Vitit, I want to say that he is not just a professor at Chulalongkorn. I think that he's a national asset for Thailand. He has served as an independent expert on different international panels, international organizations, the UN panel, currently the a member of the UN panel to inquire about the abuses in Syria. So you see the news in Syria, the UN has set up a inquiry, and Professor Vitit is a member of that inquiry team. He teaches at the Faculty of Law, he teaches international law, he has written books and articles and so on. He speaks for Thailand on many issues and current events. So without further ado, let me just go straight to Chan Vitit and let him make a presentation for 20 to 30 minutes. Chan Vitit.
Everyone, welcome to all our friends, particularly from the embassies, from other countries nearby and beyond. What I'd like to do actually is be very simple. I'm a lawyer, but the presentation this morning is slightly metaphysical. It's not quite legal. Because what I'd like to do is to invite us to look at the situation like this. It is about the case of the court. It is about the case of the court. But it's also about the metaphor of the mind. So this morning's presentation is about both. It's about the metaphor of the mind in this region, particularly between the two countries. So it's CC and MM. CC and MM. Case court and metaphor mind. That's what I like to do. And I'd like to lead us into some initial thoughts which interlink between the court and the mind, metaphorically. And then I'd like to lead us into the court cases that have been deliberated upon quickly. And you have probably my two articles done for a newspaper a while back, which I will lead you through quickly. And I know you want me to answer, how is the court going to decide this year? And the answer is very simple. Do you know what the lawyers always say? I'll be legal then. I'll say, it's sub judice. Sub judice. I reply in Latin. You can't comment. It's being deliberated upon now. So you can't comment properly. It's sub judice. So with that, it's an easy answer, but of course, opening several cans that we'll discuss indirectly, maybe. And then finally, I'll come to some areas for the future, which I hope will be useful. As a friend and inhabitant of this region, and particularly a friend of both countries. First of all, if you look at the case metaphorically in terms of the mindset, I think number one is that we should bear in mind that it's very much to do with how history in this region has been written or not written. And it's a problem of not only history, but historiography. Who has written the history of these two countries? We're not sure. And we're here to maybe supplement and rewrite a bit of that history. And my approach is a very personal history, because I don't quite believe all the books, and I'm a historian too. I went to university on history. You should have plural sources. But very often we don't have plural sources. We're taught to dislike. We're taught to hate. We're taught to mistrust. But from a personal angle, I've learned otherwise. And I will, in terms of my mind, share that with you. Historiography, and today I'm a historiographer too, in analyzing my own mind. Secondly, one good article which you can tap into on the internet analyzes the two relations, or the relations between the two countries, as not based upon a conflict between two states. It's not a conflict between two states over the temple, but more of a divergence, or potentially a conflict between different groups or different personalities in those two states and surrounding them in terms of the temple. In other words, between the two countries, there's not much except good neighborliness in reality, sort of, but the conflictual side has been spun by some elements. And if you look historically, of course it's been spun by some elements, precisely because you have to understand the history of these two countries, however it's written. Thailand went through a certain period of non-democracy, just as our neighbor went through a certain period of non-democracy, as well as war, during which many of these things happened. But if you look at the rise of Cambodia as a state, and I say that as a friend, from 1950s, Thailand was one of the countries that recognized Cambodia as a state when it came to being, and offered help, proven, just tap into the internet, offered help, including on education, including the environment, and so on. Slightly before the case arose, but help was offered upon the rise of Cambodia as a nation state. And if you look beyond the case itself, many of us offered help personally. For so many years, I was on the frontier of the Thai-Cambodian frontier, so to speak, during the influx of Cambodians in 1979. And my first piece of work was written then and there on Cambodian refugees plus the others coming in. And I've always been a friend of the Cambodian people from that era and beyond. So please think of it as something beyond the concocted, imputed state conflict or interstate conflict. There's something beyond that. Thirdly, some of the challenges that will permeate my presentation, including not only land, of course, the temple, but there's more than the temple. Much of the border is still not demarcated, but much of it can also be very peaceful at the same time, even though we don't have pillars there yet, about 800 kilometers altogether, I believe, a part of which is not demarcated yet. We have sea issues, and some elements would like to link land and sea for various reasons. We have air issues, we have environment issues, we have people issues. And paralleling those, as a test for both countries around the temple, we have peace, human rights, democracy, sustainable development, and the environment. Many of which open the door for great collaboration between the two countries, despite the divergences we may have in terms of some opinions between some groups. Fourthly, We have a variety of entry points in terms of dialogue and cooperation between the two countries, as well as dispute prevention and settlement. In a way, the temple case is to do with a bilateral between the two countries. But we have other entry points for the two countries. We have a bilateral memorandum of understanding against human trafficking. That's pretty good to have. Hopefully working quite well. Doesn't have to be conflictual at all. We have an MOU in regard to or labor migration. I think that side works a bit more smoothly than the MOU with the other side. The other side, meaning the other country on the other side, which is becoming more democratic. But we have an MOU with all the countries, including down south, including further north. Bilateral arrangements, some which work very well, despite the slightly sticky issues of deliberations on the land concerning the temple. We have sub-regional arrangements that come into play. ACMECs. I know you want me to say ASEAN. I'm going to say ACMECs. What on earth is ACMECs? Iwadi Jiao Praya Mekong Collaboration, Economic Cooperation. The most recent collaborative issue, great, between Thailand and Cambodia is this. Now we have a single visa entry for 35 countries through ACMECs so that tourists can come into Thailand and Cambodia together all at once. And Vietnam's waiting to see whether this will work. Myanmar's waiting to see whether this will work. This opened the door to great fruitfulness and fecundity in terms of collaboration between the two countries. We have the Mekong sub-region. Let's use the Mekong well, but we have other factors beyond these countries that we have to think of. Further upstream, we have to bring on board too. We have BIMSTEC, a collaboration with the South Asian countries, and we have, of course, the ASEAN 10 plus. And I won't talk too much about ASEAN or ASEAN 10 because we have the ambassador of Indonesia with us, to my welcome, Selamat Pagi, and I hope we'll warmly listen to you in terms of your wisdom on this issue, bearing in mind that ASEAN can interplay a lot with the issues here. And finally, of course, we have the non-formal collaboration. This weekend, I have to host a dinner party for the non-formal working group on ASEAN human rights mechanism. They're all coming informally, and we've been networking since the 1990s very well, including Cambodia. And I was happily in Cambodia just after the peace accords even. Together with the NGOs and so on. And then fifth, as an initial entry point, we have evidence of very good existing collaboration on many fronts. Collaboration on environment, most recently the collaboration to help Cambodia stem the illegal logging of rosewood. Rosewood collaboration, helping together. We have cross-border collaboration, working towards more economic impetus for Phra Bet and Kok Kong in future. We have what I like as a personal approach, if you tap in Youth Network, Thai-Cambodian Youth Network, which symbolizes very well the metaphor I'm talking about. One young person said that he went to this youth camp and he was mistrustful of Cambodians at that time. So the Thais always all sort of squeezed into one corner and slept there, only to find that the Cambodians provided them with blankets without their knowing during the night. So blanket statement through good deeds helped to promote collaboration, as well as all kinds of other personal approaches. I remember very fondly sending a dictionary to a Cambodian child in one of the refugee camps, Mr. Sinar, who wanted to study Thai and English. And he left Thailand, and finally, through an article that I did somewhere, I found him in New York subsequently, transmuted from this region to the United States as a good link in terms of personal relations. Those are the backgrounds, not only to the land, but to the metaphor of the mind that I like to leave with you. Now, for the court case, secondly, I just have these two cases on the CD for you, and you can even tap into them. I hope that they'll come through. Ah, all right. Oh, it's a bit sort of phased. Can you... Anyway, this is what the court case, the court report looks like in 1962. And you are most welcome to take this. It's on the internet. This is what it looks like in 1962. You probably know that the frontier between the two countries is also a consequence of the colonial happenings in this region, and of course this is a consequence of that. Now, the temple itself was an issue that was taken to court, leading to a world court decision in 1962, with the presence of 12 judges voting. The temple itself is or was on dispute territory that led to this court case. Basically, the situation ensued from the treaty between France and Thailand, which Cambodia subsequently took over from 1904. And under that treaty, it said roughly that the sort of frontier should be the watershed line, meaning wherever the water falls, so to speak, that should be the split between the two countries. But the actual map that was drawn up didn't quite follow that. And it was drawn up by a technical commission that was established. In fact, it wasn't quite the mixed commission that was established by the treaty itself, but a technical commission that came subsequently that drew up the map. And the map didn't quite follow the watershed line. So the consequence was that the temple was therefore, according to the map, according to the court's interpretation, found in Cambodian territory. And even though Thailand, before the court, said that she had mistakenly understood that this should have been on Thai territory through the map, so to speak, the court said that Thailand had acquiesced and was stopped from questioning the map itself. That's the story, quickly. And basically, you can see from my two little articles the following findings. The court, by 9-3, finds that the temple of Preah Vihear is situated in territory under the sovereignty of Cambodia. Note the wording, not on territory, in territory under the sovereignty of Cambodia. And the words in territory are very critical at this point in time. They're probably having to be interpreted by the World Court in this final phase that's coming up. This is point one the court decided upon. Point two the court decided upon was this. The court finds in consequence by 9-3 that Thailand is under an obligation to withdraw any military or police forces or other guards or keepers stationed by her at the temple or in its vicinity on Cambodian territory. That's also an issue to be decided upon. What is the vicinity? Thirdly, the court found that by 7-5, that Thailand is under an obligation to restore to Cambodia any objects of the kind specified in Cambodia's fifth submission, which may, since the date of occupation of the temple by Thailand in 1954, have been removed from the temple or the temple area by the Thai authorities. In other words, give back any artifacts taken. Third issue is not a problem, all given back. So the two issues today, prolonged for the court today, are point one and point two, not point three. And the critical words are, what do you mean situated in territory? And then point two, what do you mean in its vicinity? Basically, the court repudiated Thailand's claim over the temple. That's a fact. The court found that the country was stopped by its own conduct from rejecting a map dating back to colonial times. The court viewed this map as indicating that the temple belonged to Cambodia. That's the map that was drawn up by the technical commission, particularly around 1907, and that ensued after the treaty of 1904. Now, it's interesting that Cambodia, in taking the case to court, actually invoked five grounds, not the three only, that the court decided upon. And the court did not decide upon the first two grounds, which are also an issue today. So the three grounds that the court decided upon, you know already, in territory, in vicinity, and then give back the artifacts. The two that the court did not decide upon, which were invoked by Cambodia, were these two. Cambodia asked the court to, number one, to adjudge and declare that the map in the Dangrek sector called Annex 1 to the Memorial of Cambodia was drawn up and published in the name and on behalf of the Mixed Delimitation Commission set up by treaty of 13 Feb 1904, that it sets forth the decisions taken by the said commission, and that by reason of the fact and also of subsequent agreements and conduct of the parties, it presents a treaty character. In other words, Cambodia wanted then, in the 1960s, the court to decide that the map, this problematic map, constituted a treaty character. The court did not decide that. It didn't say anything about that. It only decided on the three that I told you about. The second point invoked by Cambodia was this: to adjudge and declare that the frontier line between Cambodia and Thailand in the disputed region in the neighborhood of the temple Preah Vihear is that which is marked on the map of the Commission of Delimitation between Indochina and Siam, in other words, Annex 1. The court did not decide on that, on the map, in terms of its implications as a frontier line. However, the court did decide upon point 3, 4, 5 that Cambodia submitted, which are the 1, 2, 3 that I was talking about. Point 3 of Cambodia, the court decided upon as its point 1 was this. Point 3 of Cambodia was to adjudge and declare that the temple is situated in territory under the sovereignty of the Kingdom of Cambodia. Point 4 of Cambodia, which is point 2 of the court, to adjudge and declare that the Kingdom of Thailand has an obligation to withdraw the detachments of armed forces it has stationed since 1954 in Cambodian territory in the ruins of the temple. And then point 3 of the court is parallel to point 5 of the Cambodian submission. In other words, to adjudge and declare that the sculptures, etc., are to be returned by the government of to be returned to the government of Cambodia by the government of Thailand to send back all the artifacts. And that has been done. So that's roughly what the court decided upon. Point 3, 4, 5, but not 1, 2. Why do I say that? Because after the case itself, Thailand withdrew its consent to the court's jurisdiction. And the court is only able to decide upon what it had decided upon in 1962 and nothing else subsequently, and not on points of law or fact which are not covered by what it had decided upon in 1962. In international law, please also bear in mind that the World Court has jurisdiction over dispute only where both parties consent to use the court. Thailand and Cambodia consented to use the court for the 1962 court case. Thailand withdrew its consent after that. However, today's case, including the 2011 case that I will talk about next, is the consequence of 1962. So it's not affected by the withdrawal of Thailand's consent subsequently. It's just a prolonged decision-making from 1962. It's not a new case. And I will come to the 2011 case next. This is the 2011 case, and I know it's a bit small, but I would like to show you very quickly the new issue, the provisional demilitarized zone on which we are now deliberating. And there's a map that you can see that I will leave with you. That's the map. I hope you can tap in. But anyway, as a consequence of 1962, as a consequence of the lack of clarity between those words in point 1 and 2, in territory, as well as in vicinity, the second stage, so to speak, of these court proceedings took place, and there was a provisional measures order in 2011 as a consequence of Cambodia's request for an interpretation of the 1962 judgment. And this 2011 interim, so to speak, decision in regards to provisional measures were very much to do with provisional measures pending the final decision making that will take place this year. the court has the power to order provisional measures if one party is threatened by irreparable prejudice. And Cambodia invoked this possibility of irreparable prejudice to ask the court to issue provisional measures as well as to deliberate finally this year. And as I said earlier, the court is only able to deliberate upon what it had decided upon in 1962 and not beyond. That's under the Article 60 of the Statute of the World Court, while Article 41 is the one that enables the World Court to issue interim measures. And what did the World Court do, the ICJ, the International Court of Justice? Thailand asked the court to dismiss the request for provisional measures, but the court still proceeded to decide as follows. Not to dismiss the request, but to proceed as follows. 16 judges voting, two of whom were ad hoc judges chosen by the two countries. The provisional measures judgment in 2011, which you have there, went as follows. The court A unanimously rejects the Kingdom of Thailand's request to remove the case introduced by Cambodia on 28 April 2011 from the general list of the court. In other words, the court said, we have jurisdiction. We don't accept Thailand's claim that the court has no jurisdiction. B indicates the following provisional measures. One, by 11 votes to 5, both parties shall immediately withdraw the military personnel currently present in the provisional demilitarized zone as defined in paragraph 62 of the present order. That's the map. 62 is pretty well the map that you have there. And refrain from any military presence within that zone and from any armed activity directed at that zone. The court, for the first time, imposed a provisional demilitarized zone. About 17 plus square kilometers. The area under dispute actually around the temple in the middle is about 4.6 square kilometers. But actually the court went further, imposing 17 plus kilometers square as a sort of protective zone, because the court looked at this very much as a World Heritage Site, which it is. It's been listed as a World Heritage Site. And that's another slightly controversial issue that I won't get into now, but we can talk about it later. So the court looked at it very much as a sort of protective zone. Provisional, but protective. Two, by 15 votes to one, Thailand shall not obstruct Cambodia's free access to the temple or Cambodia's provision of fresh supplies to its non-military personnel in the temple. Three, 15 votes to one, both parties shall continue to cooperate, the cooperation which they have entered into with ASEAN, we have the ambassador there, and in particular allow the observers appointed by that organization to have access to the provisional demilitarized zone. I believe observers have not been allowed in yet, but we have other peaceful arrangements at play, which we also welcome. Fourth, by 15 votes to one, both parties shall refrain from any action which may aggravate or extend the dispute before the court or make it more difficult to resolve. And then C, by 15 votes to one, decides that each party shall inform the court as to its compliance with the above measures. And then finally, D, by 15 votes to one, decides that until the court has rendered judgment this year, it remains seized of the matter which form the subject of this order. In other words, the court finally said also, we still have the power. We're seized of the matter. We're not detached from the matter. What are some of the implications of this court case? I try and reduce this to a quick 10 implications. As you know, the court is only able to deliberate upon what it had decided upon in 1962, particularly points 1, 2, 3 under the Article 60 of the court statute. So some of the issues of interest include the following. Number one, the court linked its reasoning with the application of Article 41 of the court statute. In other words, opening the door to provisional measures pending final court proceedings this year. basically, Article 41 empowers the court to order these provisional measures to, quote, preserve the respective rights of either party. In the recent decision, it recognized the plausible character of the rights asserted by a party interrelated with the need to prevent irreparable prejudice or damage. In other words, a threat of harm, according to the court, to the temple in Cambodia, justified the provisional measures as well as the provisional demilitarized zone. Two, the issue of the court's establishment of a provisional demilitarized zone binding on the two parties is very interesting. This measure is perhaps the most interesting of all. The court did not order the pullout of troops by one party alone, but targeted both countries. Both sides will have to prove to the court that they withdrew their military personnel immediately, as highlighted below. In reality, there might also be an issue concerning who constitutes military personnel. Today, some have been withdrawn, redeployed, and some police are going in. My understanding is that not all have been withdrawn yet. But at least it's peaceful. At least civilians are going in. And of course, our friends, the observers, possibly, are also waiting in the wings. Thirdly, the court also asked both parties to refrain from having any military presence within that zone and from any armed activity directed at that zone. And I think very happily, since the court case, we've been quiet. We've been quiet, happily. The zone under this measure covers about 17 square kilometers, you see on the map there, and is outlined by the provisional map up there, defined in paragraph 62, that's 62 there, which the court itself drew up, and which is almost quadrangular in shape. The area covered by this map is broader than the 4.6 square kilometers surrounding the temple under the dispute between the two countries. And it reaches into the undisputed territories of both sides. It is also not the map, Annex 1, from the colonial times, which was a key bone of contention and is a key bone of contention between the two parties in the 1962 judgment of the court until today. This is not the map from 1907. It's a new quadrangle from the court. Fourth, five judges in dissent. The lawyer always has to read the dissent, not just the majority. Five judges in dissent questioned the establishment of the provisional demilitarized zone, indicating that this exceeded the court's powers. That's interesting. Five out of 10 plus. These judges looked to other possible options rather than a DMZ, or provisional demilitarized zone, drawn up by the court. They opted for other possibilities, such as a ceasefire between the two sides, a line agreed upon by the parties themselves, possibly with observers, unobstructed access and support from ASEAN, a line imposed by the UN Security Council under Chapter 7 of the UN Charter on Peace and Security, and or an order of withdrawal of troops under an agreement between the two sides. These were the options the dissenters wanted. But the majority vote imposed that, which you have. The dissenting judges had in mind, in particular, the considerations of national sovereignty and the potential impingement on such sovereignty by the setting of such provisional DM zone. One dissenting judge went further by noting that the court had never imposed a zone like that in any situation in a court case. Interesting, this is unique. In early cases of the court, concerning other countries where provisional measures were ordered, the court only ordered withdrawal of forces based on a ceasefire. For example, in the disputes between Burkina Faso and Mali, Cameroons and Nigeria, and most recently between Costa Rica and Nicaragua. Six, the issue of free access to the temple. Basically, the court ordered Thailand not to obstruct Cambodia's free access to the temple or Cambodia's provision of fresh supplies to its non-military personnel in the temple. In practice, the notion of free access is subject to interpretation, like all legal things. And much will depend upon the two countries to come together peacefully to arrange the administrative, logistical, and other implications of access. Six, the court's call to both sides to cooperate with ASEAN, in particular to allow observers from ASEAN to have access to the mentioned zone. What about that? This has not been implemented fully, but it's a logical measure given that ASEAN, through Indonesia as chairman then, has already been involved at a certain level in terms of offering a helping hand. Terima kasih. Thank you. It should be recalled also for both parties that there is the ASEAN Charter, which advocates a rules-based approach based upon peaceful settlement disputes with all kinds of dispute settlement mechanisms that ASEAN countries don't use. ASEAN countries don't quite use ASEAN dispute settlement mechanisms. Why? Malaysia, Indonesia go to the World Court. Myanmar recently with Bangladesh went to the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea in Hamburg. Interesting, eh? A slight hesitation to use ASEAN dispute settlement mechanisms. This also complements the court's call to both sides to refrain from any action which might aggravate the dispute. Seven, the court's indication to both sides that they need to inform the court of their compliance with provisional measures. And of course, they're going to meet up in April very soon, so presumably some information will flow there. And the court was categorical in saying that its decisions, provisional or otherwise, are of binding effect, and the court remains seized of the issue. And yet we have to deal with the internal dynamics of these countries, which might think otherwise for other reasons. Dialogue is thus needed internally too. Eight, the court's decision to remain seized of the issue means that the next phase of proceedings is now. Hearings again in April, and possibly, hopefully, a final decision by the end of the year. Finality, but not to forget other entry points in terms of assistance, cooperation, and dialogue. The decision by the end of this year will thus hark back to the power of the court to interpret its 1962 decision and the various operative clauses mentioned. No more and no less. Nine, at stake will be how the court will interpret the words territory and vicinity which appear in those clauses. 1, 2, 3, particularly 1, 2 operative clauses earlier. Equally important will be how the court will navigate its deliberations to avoid exceeding its powers under its own statute, given that the 1962 judgment is not open to appeal, but can merely be interpreted. It is not an appeal. It's not an appellate situation. It's a mere extension of 62 in terms of interpretation. And finally, 10, needless to say, legal solutions are not necessarily exhaustive and should be paralleled by enlightened leadership, constructive diplomatic channels, policy and other inputs to nurture a sense of empathy and understanding. And if you really want to know how to enforce the court decision, then you have to go to the top. It is the Security Council that helps to enforce. The court's decision is binding, but of course the court doesn't have military and other powers, and you have to go to the total UN system. So that's where we are today, and those of you who want me to be saying the crystal ball, well, the crystal ball is very simple. The court's deliberations are sub judice. I will just round off with some thoughts for the future very quickly. The case, the court, the metaphor, and the mind. Number one, please take to heart that the World Court and other international mechanisms are at the heart of the global rule of law. Let's respect them. Let's not denigrate them. Two, it is a shared challenge between not only the two countries, but everyone here and beyond, a task for governments and non-governments in both countries and beyond, to prepare the peoples constructively for the court judgment. We want a win-win, mentally at least. Win-win may just mean a certain understanding. We don't want a din-din. Din, the sound of discord. We don't want a din-din. We want a win-win. Three, the court's case must be seen in the totality of Thai-Cambodian relations in the regional and global context. We are part of ASEAN, we are part of the world in terms of prevention of disputes, dispute settlement, as well as dispute management. Fourth, we can be proud of the vistas of cooperation that are already taking place that can be further maximized. Your bilateral ACMEX plus ACMEX in terms of the visa for the two countries is one decision which is very good, coming into the two countries without visa for 35 countries. We can be proud of forthcoming economic collaboration on land not far from the temple, Poipet, Kokkong. I know that the sea issue is a sticky one, but it's not impossible. We have modalities for peaceful settlement of maritime disputes. Thailand is now a member of the Law of the Sea Convention, and Cambodia is a signatory. We have ways of dealing. And remember, Bangladesh and Myanmar went very nicely to the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea to settle their disputes, just as Indonesia, Singapore, and Malaysia go to the International Court of Justice in terms of Lipidan, Middle Rocks, Pulau, whatever, what Pulau, islands, and settle well before the World Court. Sea issues are not all at sea. They can be dealt with nicely. Air issues. Now we are liberalizing through ASEAN air-related issues in terms of even catering, I believe. So air traffic, air liberalization, tourism coming in with a single visa, much welcomed, I would hope, through ACMEX, ASEAN or otherwise. Environment, we welcome collaboration, Rosewood or otherwise. Ironically, even watershed management, which is very important. And finally, people to people. We have Thai Cambodian volunteers coming to play, youth network that I welcome very much, just as those Thais and Cambodians were sharing their blankets a little while back, and just as I was sharing my dictionary with my young friend Sina, now in the US. And then finally, fifth, let's learn by doing together. Cooperation, education programs, increasing cross-cultural exchanges from a young age to nurture a sense of understanding. We must learn to understand our neighbors more, even rewrite history perhaps, historically and historiographically. Let's learn to write the history together, to have a plural and alternative history of examples of convergence and confluence rather than divergence and conflict. It is a history being built, even today, of shared responsibility and a shared destiny. It is ultimately the hearts and minds that will resonate and that are transcendent. Thank you.
Now I have just a quick question as follow up. Just we take up a 1 minute answer. I know that we are not supposed to intrude and trespass into court deliberations and all of that, but we are interested still in potential outcomes, outcome scenarios. Is it fair to say that there are basically two outcome scenarios? One is that there's nothing to say, nothing new to say from the court, nothing new to adjudicate. And two, that there is something new to adjudicate based on 1962, and that is the two key words, vicinity and territory, and vicinity more important. Ajahn, is that the case, more or less?
Well, the lawyer always gives a reply that's not quite yes or no, but it depends.
From a Chulalongkorn professor today. Yeah.
So let's do it like this. Number one, it is an admissible case. No issue of admissibility. The issue is merits to do with interpretation. And I think the court will do its best to be wise and work towards a win-win situation, actually. In a way, the provisional demilitarized zone is a win-win. Doesn't please either side totally, but it doesn't displease either side either. Plus, it has a third factor coming into play in terms of help from neighbors. So if that's the flow of the situation, it might be inspiring the court towards something along that line.
Okay, thank you.